now, Inside the Juke Joint Live.
And once again, I'm your host, Leonard Brown, along with my co-host, Mr. Red G. Dwayne Mackoff, also of Fairfield's very own controllers.
Hello, Birmingham. Hello to the entire world. We are waist deep into the Memorial Day weekend. You already know you're in the place where you listen, learn, and grow. Traveling at the speed of sound, we're inside the Juke Joint, and so are you. Are you ready?
Mm-hmm.
You must be set.
I am.
LB.
Yes.
Do the giddy up. Giddy up.
Oh, yeah. You had a good help in the coffee this morning. Okay, you.
I cracked myself
yeah,
up.
I know you do. And ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Jason Ladd, engineer and producer extraordinaire.
Good morning, Birmingham, and everybody else out there.
No, that's right. And ladies and gentlemen, our very special guest this morning is none other than Mr. Otis Williams of the world famous group,
The Temptations.
And we're going to be talking to him in a minute. But first, let me shout out to all my military personnel out there and to all my military families out there. We want you to know that we love you. We salute you. And all of us here inside the Juke Joint, thank you so, so very much for your sacrifice.
Absolutely. Happy Memorial Day.
That's right.
Glad to have you home.
I'm telling you. And ladies and gentlemen, it's time to put on that bag, and better known as LLG, and that's Listen, Learn, and Grow. So without further ado, would you please, please welcome our super friend this morning, Mr. Otis Williams of the world-famous group, The Temptations. Ow. Otis, how you doing this morning, bro?
Oh, Leonard and Reggie, I must really love y'all. Y'all have me up out here on the West Coast at 9 o'clock in the morning.
No o'clock. You're too much.
Oh, you're too much. Oh, I tell you what we're going to do for anybody that's been absolutely dead. And just arisen, just this morning, we're going to play a song by the Temps that you cannot deny. The name of that song, Reggie, is...
Why don't you just get ready?
Get yourself that way. On 987 KISS FM. Here we go. And once again, ladies and gentlemen, if you're just joining us, you're inside the Juke Joint on 987 KISS FM. And again, I'm your host, Leonard Brown, and we are talking to Mr. Otis Williams of the world-famous group, The Temptations. And we want to thank him again for getting up this early. Y'all don't know the price I got to pay for this, but it's a price.
That's right. That's right.
I said, oh, that's right.
Otis, we were picking up from where we started last week, and some of the songs that we did last week were absolutely incredible on the TV show here. And you really got the city stirred up big time from the last interview we had, because I have some different questions I want to kind of ask you this time around, and in dealing with the amount of time that you actually been with the Temptations, I wanted to ask you about the business side. I hate to start out right with that, but it's on my mind. And because of a guy like yourself, I know that the business world, you were deep into it, and for you to achieve what you have achieved, can you tell me or tell us the level of business that you had to deal with to be where you are now?
Well, you know, oftentimes in show business, the word business come up before show, because it is that, you know, and we learned that as we started out in the business, you know, and sometimes it's easy to forget that, you know, you have to take care of business to be in the show, part of business. And, you know, it's just, it's been a quantum leap from the way it was when we started out back during the 60s in comparison to the way show business has evolved now, but nevertheless, it's still business. And, you know, sometimes learning about the way the business is, it can be rough, you know, because you don't know it, you know, when you first start off. So you make mistakes and what have you, but you try not to make costly mistakes, but sometimes that's the only way you learn, you know, is through mistakes. But I tell kids and people when I do go around speaking, see, when we started out back during the 60s, there was no self-help books educating you about being in show business.
No.
And now you can educate yourself, you know, because I had to learn myself by listening at people talk. And I'm a voracious reader, you know, so I have books about being in show business and, you know, the pitfalls and how much a manager should get and should not get and things. So it's something that the artists of the day should bone up on, because if you're going to be in show business, you know, you should really learn about it, because now there's a whole new part of the media that the show business part has progressed to, and, you know, because we didn't have no iTunes and, you know, all kind of, you know, outlets where you can get your music and what have you when we started out. So it's a whole new ball of wax now, and it would behoove kids or people, not only kids, but whomever is coming into the business, to really, really bone up about being in the show business and know how to get the best deal you can get, you know, at that stage of when you come into the business, and evolve into, you know, doing as well as you can, because this business is a tricky business.
Yes.
Bernard, you know how it
you
is.
You know, I know, man.
Yeah.
I was looking at American Idol the other night, as a matter of fact, when the young man won the contest.
Right.
And I was thinking, out of all of what I was seeing, all of the celebration and all of this and that, and I was saying to myself, this is just not starting for him. He has no clue.
No,
that
not
this
at
is
all.
Just about to start. Because.
Yeah. But,
so let me ask you this, because I've asked several other artists this. How do you feel about these kids coming, like, right out of the grocery store, coming right out of any of these little small places with a small job, and all of a sudden everybody in the world knows their name? How do you feel about them actually starting these kids at the top? Because sometimes I have trouble with it, because I know the only place they can go is down. They got to come down, you know, in some instances.
Sure.
So what is your feelings about that?
Well, you know, success, you know, a lot of times can come in the most peculiar kind of way. But for us, you know, when we started out, we really just had to learn a whole lot about being in show business. The blessed part about what the temps were when we came along with Motown, you know, they taught us about show business.
Mm-hmm.
We had to be at artist development every morning that started at like 9 or 10 o'clock
in
the morning.
That's right.
And wouldn't come out there until 6.
That's right.
A lot of these artists nowadays, that when they come along, they don't have that kind of training. You know, it's almost like fast food. They get success real quick, and then they don't know how to hold on to it. They don't educate themselves about being in it, you know. But one man's poison can be another man's feast.
That's true.
If they can get it that kind of way, but if they can maintain about how to be in show business without getting cocky, you know, because like I said, we had to go through a lot of things to really understand about show business, and it made me and us very appreciative, because it was an educated kind of thing for us to learn about it, and we have developed into being in show business. We made it our vocation rather than our avocation, because we really wanted to make it our lifestyle. We were taught about being in show business, whether we never get another hit record or not, we still can work and command real big dollars, in the sense of because we want to be in show business for our livelihood, not just for the flashiness of it and the quickness of it. And then next thing you know, when you run into a dry spell, you don't know how to handle it. Because I say this, I don't care who you are, everybody gets a cooling spell.
That's right.
Nothing and no one stays hot forever. And it's during those times that when you find out what you're made of, when you know the lights kind of dim down, and you find yourself say, oh, the bright lights is kind of getting dim. You know, so everybody gets a hot spell. You know, like I said, I'm a voracious reader, and you can go all the way back to Elvis Presley, as great as he was, he had a cooling spell. Here come the Beatles, as great as they were, they had a cooling spell after a period of time. As big as Motown was, we were riding the crest for a long time, that's a cooling spell. I don't care who you are, everybody's going to get that cooling spell, and that's when you find out what you're made of. So we went through a lot, and it made us very appreciative, because here we're talking about 51 years. You know why 51 years? Because we wanted to be in show business for the sake of being in show business and really taking it in the real business sense. So it's something that you really have to try and understand, because show business can be a very strong aphrodisiac. You know, it'll be wonderful one minute, and next thing you know, you're pitching yourself because where's all the adulation? Where's all the doors not opening up? You know, so it's an educating process, and you know, we've just been fortunate enough to take it, like I said, for our vocation rather than our avocation.
Well, it's what I've learned is that when those spells come around, you have to learn. And you have to not be too proud to beg.
Is that a nice segue?
Let's go with that song right now. Ladies and gentlemen, ain't too proud to beg. By the Temptations, here we go.
But I refuse to let you go. If I have to beg, plead for your sympathy, I don't mind, cause you mean that much to me. Ain't too proud to beg. Don't leave me, girl. Ain't too proud to plead, baby, baby. Please don't leave me, girl.
Once again, ladies and gentlemen, if you just joined us, you're inside the Juke Joint on 987 KISS FM. Again, I'm your host, Lenard Brown, and we're talking to Mr. Otis Williams of the world-famous group, The Temptations. We want you to stay with us. We're going to take a small break. We'll be back in just a minute.
JB's House of Fashion. Your fashion headquarters, catering to that man and woman with the latest styles for the most sophisticated look. Also, the latest in gospel music, traditional as well as contemporary, 1630 3rd Avenue West, Birmingham. Open from Monday through Saturday from 10 a.m. to 6 p.m. For more information, simply call 788-4491 or log on to www.jb'shouseoffashion.
Here at the Charter International Dateline facility, scientists have one foot in today and one foot literally in tomorrow to bring charter customers the latest thing. Oh, it's Casual Friday over here. Like switching your phone service from AT&T, Verizon, or CenturyLink, Charter guarantees to cut your phone bill in half. Speaking of cutting things in half, where's the rest of those pants?
And once again, ladies and gentlemen, if you just joined us, you're inside the Juke Joint on 987 KISS FM. Again, I'm your host, Lenard Brown, and we are talking to Mr. Otis Williams of the world-famous group, The Temptations. Otis, did you ever play ball?
No, not really. You know, I was so into singing. And you know what my other passion was?
What was it, my brother?
Art. I would sit down and just sketch most of the day, aside from, I did play baseball, but singing and sketching. If it had not been for Motown, I very possibly would have been with some large commercial firm sketching. So I would sit and sketch all day long and chase girls.
You made that long a patient, did you?
Well, you know, man can't live by bread alone.
No,
you
can't. Okay, Otis, that was a good occupation. I believe I took notes from you somewhere along the way with that. It was a very interesting time of life, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah. Young boy just growing up learning the ways of life.
On that note, we're going to go to another song. And the name of that song, Reggie, is?
Beauty.
Is where?
Is only skin deep. But ugly?
Is where?
To the bone.
Oh, there we go, ladies and gentlemen. 987 KISS FM. Listen up.
Oh,
Once again, ladies and gentlemen, if you just joined us, you're inside the Juke Joint on 987 KISS FM. And again, we are talking to Mr. Otis Williams of the world famous group,
The Temptations.
Yo, Birmingham.
No, that's right. Otis, I want to ask you this question, man, because in dealing, once again, I was talking to you earlier about being it and being able to see it. You just can't do both because, like you were saying, we know you, Otis Williams of the Temptations, and we see you all like this, but how you see yourself, I'm sure it's got to be a lot different than the rest of us because you know you have to still do all the things every day like every other human being. But I wanted to ask you this. Has anyone ever asked you throughout your years, what has this music business, because it is a brutal business, has anyone ever asked you what have this business done to you?
Well, music, you know, is a powerful force. It has been great to me, for me, and for everyone connected with me and farther than I can imagine. So music is a wonderful antidote. I love it. Can you imagine what this world would be like without music? A big void. It wouldn't be the kind of world that we are, you know, as far as enjoying certain things in life. And music has had a powerful impact on me. See, I'm from Texarkana, and I was raised by both grandmothers, you know, and back when I was in Texas in my formative years, I couldn't listen to anything but gospel music. I didn't find out about the secular music until I moved to Detroit, you know, and I was about 14 years old, and that's when I really, aside from listening at the great gospel group singers, you know, harmonizing for Dixie Hummingbirds and Swan Silvertone, and then when I moved up to Detroit when the great rock and roll shows started happening, that's when I really started learning the power of music, because the Fox Theater is the second largest indoor theater in America. Radio City is the first. Mm-hmm. But you know, Leonard and Richard, to see what one artist or five guys out on the stage or however the act might be, to have command of 5,000 people going crazy over the music that these people are doing on stage left a powerful impact on a young kid from Texas at 12 or 13 years old. You know, so music is a wonderful antidote, and I'm learning. You know, I'm not going to say, well, I've learned a lot. I'm still learning because life is ever learning. Right. But music is a powerful, powerful thing to have. I tell you what music has meant to me. We were playing Ole Miss. Now, this is when Eddie and I were together along with David, Eddie, Paul, and Melvin. And we got into this college in Mississippi, and we got there kind of early. So we were there watching the guy set up the stage, put the trussels up and what have you. But black folks came to see us as well, but they wanted to sit down front, you know, but they didn't have the tickets to sit down front. They were scheduled to sit on the side of the stage. So when the white folks came there to sit down, you know, it was almost a conflict, you know. But Eddie Kendricks and myself walked out, and we asked the technicians to give us some power so we could talk over the microphone. And we said, please don't do this. We came to perform for everybody, so please sit in your rightful seats. The powerful thing that I learned about music is that the incident could erupt into something not good.
That's true.
But black folks went and sat where they were supposed to sit, and the white folks sat down front. But as Eddie and I walked off the stage, I said, wow, Eddie, they listened at what we had to say. All we did was just sing, you know. But I guess by us being who we are and, you know, the music that we were doing at the time, they stopped and listened to what we were saying. And then, like I said, it made a powerful impact on me because, hey, we were singers. But for that moment in time, they listened at us like if we were a heavyweight politician or what have you. So music has far-reaching impacts, and that was one that I will always remember.
On that note, Otis, we're going to play You're My Everything, because you guys not only were singers, you were politicians that day. So
yeah, you're right. You're very right.
You guys was everything. We're going to play that song right now on 987 KISS FM.